Hi, I'm Sari Kimmel with Food Business Success, and welcome to Unwrapped. I am your host. I am a packaged food business expert, and today we are talking about a very popular topic and one that I get a lot of questions on. And in fact, I was talking with Sarah of Third Bird Collective, who was just on the podcast this week. And she was telling me that this was one of her biggest questions when she first was starting out, was around working in a commercial kitchen. And so I wanted to come on and talk about that today. So, of course, if you have any questions, you're welcome to type those into the chat. But let's talk about when you need to get a commercial kitchen. So let's pretend you already know that your product is not cottage food, or you want to go into a retail environment. So you want to start selling wholesale. So you know you need a commercial kitchen. All right. So the first thing is we need to find a kitchen. And so some of the things to consider when you're looking for a commercial kitchen is, of course, price per hour, or sometimes they are a fixed fee, but you want to look for kitchens that have a reasonable price per hour. It's going to really depend on your location. You know, where I'm at in Colorado, oftentimes we see more like $25, $30 an hour. If you're in California or Seattle or some places like that, you're going to definitely have more expensive kitchens. You know, it kind of depends on your product and how much time you're going to need. It may be worthwhile trying to find a fixed rate where you get a certain number of hours for a fixed rate, or just like unlimited time. I mean, sometimes people, if they're baking a lot, they just need a lot more time. And then some people are making a shelf-stable sauce, right? And so you don't need to go in all that often. You just need a big chunk of time to do that run. Other things to consider are storage. So does it have, if you need refrigeration, if you need freezer space, do you have access to a dry storage shelf? Understanding what those fees are and if they have that availability. So if you have a product that needs to be refrigerated, or the ingredients need to be refrigerated or frozen, that is something that the health department would look at to say, do you have the adequate storage? You also want to be keeping, so any ingredients or packaging that is opened inside the kitchen needs to stay in the kitchen. So you can't take that with you back and forth. If it's unopened, that's fine. You can store it at home. And once the product's finished, then you can take it home. But you can't store unopened product outside of the kitchen. And then, of course, looking for the availability of hours that you need. So, you know, kind of matching that time and then hours needed, hours available. Sometimes places only have like late night shifts when you first start because all their daytime stuff is filled up. It may not even be a traditional commissary kitchen. So maybe they're a restaurant that's open during the day, so you can only get in the evening, or vice versa. So definitely making sure that those hours are going to work for you. Location is a big one as well. When you think about your time spent in travel time and gas, of course. So we do want to be mindful of that. I don't recommend getting something too far away, because it kind of depends. Again, if it's like something you have to be in there daily, like a kombucha brewer or baking, something like that, then, you know, the location is really going to matter. If it's like a one-time, once-a-month thing, you're going to go in and bottle, maybe it's not such a big deal. Equipment, super important that you look at equipment. And do they have some maybe the mixers that you need, or the ovens, right? If you're baking, you definitely need ovens. But you can also look for equipment that's like a nice to have. Some kitchens will have like fillers for bottling, or label machines, things like that. So always nice to look and see what all their equipment is. always look at what are the contract obligations? Am I signing up month to month? Is this an annual thing? We don't recommend doing an annual agreement. There's a lot that can happen in a year, and I hate for you to get stuck in something like that. And then will you need to put down a deposit or not? So all things to consider when you're looking at your budget. And then what I like to do is inside Food Business Success in our Pricing for Profit module, we have all of our cost of goods sold. And so I like to look and see, you know, depending on how much this kitchen is, like how many units do you need to sell to break even or to pay for that kitchen? So it's important to look at that because I think sometimes we get a little blinded and we don't actually look at the real numbers and we take the drama out of it, but we just look at the math. So I highly recommend doing that. And then some other things to know when you, usually what happens is you're going to reach out to them, to the commissary kitchen, and how you can find them are, thekitchennextdoor.com is a good resource. You might just be able to search like commissary kitchens plus your city. The reality is depending on where you live, there may not be traditional commissary kitchens that are like commercial kitchens specifically for rent. So I always recommend to my clients, even when they do have options, but like depending on their product and what makes sense, could they use a bakery that's only open in the morning and they go in the evenings? Could they use a school or a daycare or a church even, or a restaurant that's only open in the evenings? I've had people use nightclubs. So they just have to have, it has to be a commercial kitchen. It needs a The way you start anyway to identify is you look around, like let's say you're in a church, do they have a 3-compartment sink? That is your first clue that they might be certified and licensed as a commercial kitchen. So do know you don't have to work out of a commissary kitchen specifically. You need to work out of a commercial kitchen. So you do have some other options potentially. So when you meet, you'll email the owner, you may go back and forth. You may have to follow up with them a few times. Don't take it personal. Just keep following up, sending that reminder email every 5-7 days until you hear back. And then they'll probably want to schedule an in-person meeting with you so you can see the space, ask them questions. And so eventually, once you've all agreed, you're going to get something usually called a commissary agreement. It might be called something a little bit different where you live, but it's a piece of paper that is going to go with your license applications. And you may have two, depending on if you're getting, some states require a separate wholesale license versus a direct-to-consumer license. So you may have two commissary agreements you need. Oftentimes, the kitchen owner managers, they know this stuff. So ask them in advance if there's paperwork that they recommend you bring. But essentially, this piece of paper is signed by them that says, we are holding your space for you in this kitchen. So once you get your license, you can come back here and work. So it's important that you stay in communication, that you maintain a good relationship, you let the owner know if things are getting delayed for some reason. A lot of times people are very excited and they're like, yay, I'm going to start next month. And then there's delays or there's personal things that happen. And so it's just important to communicate if you're getting, you know, if things are going to get delayed. All right. So that's about finding the kitchen. So once you are in a kitchen, I realized, and this was something Sarah brought up that I was like, oh yeah, when you haven't worked in a commercial kitchen, it can be a little bit scary. It can be a little like intimidating, not quite sure how to act. So I want to give you some tools, some do's and don'ts when you are working in a commercial kitchen, because it is different than obviously your home kitchen. And there are ways that you can be much more successful if you're going into a kitchen. So I want to help you with that. If you've never been in a kitchen or it's been a long time, maybe you waited tables or something when you were younger, but it may have been a while. So a couple things to do. You do want to make sure you are wearing appropriate clothing, that you are, you know, you shouldn't be in there in like tank tops and shorts. Like, I'm not saying you need to like be fully clothed, bundled up, but we want to think about cleanliness and hygiene. We want to pull our hair back if it's long. Guys, if you have a big beard, you want to wear like a beard net. You want to have gloves. You want to have appropriate shoes so that they're non-slip. So having some specific shoes for the kitchen, they could be athletic shoes or I love dance goes. That's what I always waited tables in. Or Doc Martens are another good one. So I would just have clothing that's like meant for the kitchen that you're not too worried about getting dirty, getting wet, because it will happen. All right. So the number one rule is that you want to be a good partner. You want to work well with others. You want to, be generous and create good relationships inside the kitchen, whether it's with other tenants, because there's probably other people working in that kitchen, or just with the kitchen owner. So just go in, be ready to honestly, there's super valuable information that you can get from people who work in kitchens because they're doing it ahead of you, right? And they know a lot of the things not to do. So the kitchen, when you enter it, when you're going in for your shift, and typically you're going to schedule shifts. The kitchen will have some way for you to schedule a shift. Usually it's not just drop in because they want to be sure that, even if there's, they want to be sure you have the space that you need. Sometimes you have to reserve equipment ahead of time as well. But when you come in, it should be clean and it should be ready to go. It should be all sanitized. It should be clean from the previous people. And then as you get working, you're going to want to just make sure you're tidying up as you go. I do not recommend saving all the dishes for the end. Like, get efficient and kind of clean as you go. I think one of the biggest things that's very different from working in a home kitchen is that the sanitizing process. So there it should be a food grade sanitizer in the kitchen. And you need to understand how important this is and how it works. And please ask for help from the kitchen manager or somebody working in the kitchen if you don't know. But if you are alone in there, the first thing you want to do is fill up. You're going to have a 3-compartment sink and you're going to do soapy water, clean water for rinsing, and then sanitizer water. And sanitizer water, you're going to add your food grade sanitizer, and there is a certain amount that you should do, and they should have test strips. So that is something that the health department looks for, is that you are testing that sanitizer. You also want a bucket of sanitizer. So anytime you change tasks and you're cleaning up, you want to clean it and then sanitize your surface. So this is going to be really important for like shelf life and not having cross-contamination. And it helps to kind of prevent like yeast and mold and other things getting into the food. As long as you're keeping everything sanitized, you're wearing gloves, right? This is a food operation. You're dealing with food. So there is a certain level of food safety. So that sanitizer thing, I think, can be just like, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. So I want to be sure you guys really understand that and ask for help. Be prepared to not be as efficient, of course, the first few times. I was just talking to one of my one-on-one clients yesterday, and it's been a few months since she's been in her kitchen doing her kombucha. And she's like, oh my gosh, we're finally getting our processes down. Like, the first month or so was just a mess. Like, I was buying way too much fruit and it was taking so long. And, you're learning something new. So realize that you're not going to be very efficient the first few times, the first month. Give yourself some grace to know that. And what I think will really help you to get better, because ultimately, this time that we spend in the kitchen is going to be part of our cost of goods sold, at least the time spent, right? Like, if you were going to pay somebody else, this is part of your cost of goods sold. So some things that'll help you to get faster sooner are that you really want to document everything. What are the the time, you know, document the time that you spend on tasks when you get to the kitchen, how long it takes you to set up, document like things that are working, or things that aren't. Like, I need to figure out a better solution for this particular step in the process. Look at your speed of like how fast you can go, but also look at like document things like what was the mixer time if you were mixing up something, how long, what was the speed on. And so really document all this stuff, the weights of the ingredients you used, because it seems like in the moment you're going to remember. You're like, oh yeah, I'll remember that. Oh yeah, don't do that for next time. And I promise you, you will forget if you do not write it down. So you need a list to be keeping notes and getting better, refining it. Because the longest way to do it is to never write anything down and then every time be like, oh yeah, I was supposed to do that. Or this would help if I do that. Or I should bring this thing. Or whatever it is, you're always going to forget. And it might take you a couple of times before you realize. So you might as well like skip ahead and not do all that. And then ultimately, keeping in mind that as we document and as we get faster and more efficient, and we get used to being in the kitchen and where everything is and the setup and the cleanup and all of that, ultimately, all of that is going to improve your cost of goods sold, which is a great thing. And we also need to know where to problem solve. So we can go back and look at that list of what we did and say, oh, where are the opportunities for me to solve some problems here? So that's super important once you're in a kitchen. Making sure that you are keeping your logs updated, or if the kitchen has logs, this is part of your food safety plan. So especially if you're heating and then cooling things, you need to be logging that. You're probably going to have your own personal logs for that, but there may be some things that the kitchen wants logs for as well. Label and date all your open items. So it's important that, again, from a food safety, if the health department were to come by, that you have sealed your products that you're keeping there, like something in the refrigerator, and you're putting the date that it was opened. That's just good practice when you're in a commercial kitchen. Take inventory for the next time. The worst thing you can do is like you leave the kitchen and you're not coming back for a month and you don't take stock of what you already have. And then you're like, oh, now I got to go back to the kitchen. So make it a habit, maybe having a list of all your ingredients and packaging and just doing a quick like inventory of what you have left after that production day. That'll save you a ton of time. Factor in, now we're into cleanup. You've done all of your production, and then you need to make sure that cleanup time is factored in to that shift. So you, like, let's say your shift is from 10 to 2. At 2 o'clock, you need to be done walking out the door because there may be another shift coming in at 2. So it's very important that you're keeping aware of time management and that you are staying on top of things. I would set an alarm for like 30 minutes ahead of the time you're supposed to be done and start cleaning up. This way you want to clean as you go. It'll make things a lot easier. But everything needs to be washed, rinsed, sanitized, dry, and it should be air drying ideally. And then everything needs to get put away. And all your surfaces need to be clean. You're probably going to need to sweep. Maybe you need to mop. You should find out all of that from your kitchen manager, what needs to be done. Maybe the trash needs to be taken out, the recycling, whatever it is. All of that needs to be done on time for the end of your shift. And then lastly, just be a good partner, be a good tenant, communicate all issues, any issues to management quickly. If you come in and the kitchen's not clean, communicate that, because ultimately, you know, if you have to clean the kitchen, like that's taking away time that should be ready to go. And so you may want to negotiate some extra time with that, but letting them know so they can quickly follow up with the previous renter. If there's any equipment issues, any beeping, anything like that, you want to make sure and communicate those. So that's what I have for you today on finding a commercial kitchen and how to work best in one, how to be most successful. because ultimately your product profitability will be factored in with your ability to work quickly and efficiently in a kitchen. And you know, just want it to be a really good fit and that you feel comfortable in there. So I hope that was helpful. If you want more help with any of this, I mentioned the cost of goods sold worksheet. Or if you have questions about how do I find a kitchen, any of your licensing, some of these other things we talked about today, I just want to invite you to come join me inside Food Business Success. And we have a little reinvention happening towards the end of the month. So the program's getting a little reworked and it's going to be amazing. So you want to go check out foodbizsuccess.com and come check it out. Come join me inside the program where you can get on group calls with me and be able to ask me your questions, which is amazing.